Hello again, I'm Lynn Thompson. Today is the 20th of February. This week, we're in the second half of a two-part series on When Government Acts as Book Critic. And this week, we're taking note of the 67th anniversary of the creation of the Georgia Literature Commission. A remarkable essay in censorship that flourished out of Atlanta for a long time. For 27 years, seven men labored to stanch the flow of paperbacks they described as so bad the devil would blush. Several died on duty. Here's what the new Georgia Encyclopedia said of the Georgia Literature Commission. Georgia launched its first major campaign against obscene literature in 1953, when the General Assembly unanimously voted to establish the Georgia Literature Commission. The onset of the paperback book revolution in the years after World War II, the rising popularity of adult magazines, and the introduction of Playboy magazine in the United States led the legislature to create the commission, consisting of three members who would meet monthly to investigate literature they suspected would be, quote, detrimental to the morals of the citizens of Georgia. If the commission determined something to be obscene, it had the power to inhibit distribution by notifying the distributor, and then 30 days later, recommending prosecution by the area prosecuting attorney. Governor Herman Talmadge appointed Atlanta Minister James P. Wesbury, Royston, Georgia newspaper publisher Hubert Dyer, and Greensboro theater owner William R. Boswell to four-year terms on the commission. Writing in the Georgia Historical Quarterly in 2000, Gregory Lisby chronicled the post-World War II era's concerns over moral standards that seem to have gotten lost in the exigencies of world conflict, what with all the men gone, the women working, and the kids latchkeying themselves home every afternoon. The paperback revolution and the rise of girly magazines found ready audiences in millions of demobilized servicemen for whom Betty Grable pinups lacked the allure they'd had, say, back in 1942. Thus, the Georgia General Assembly voted to pass House Bill 247. The commission was charged as a study agency to investigate and recommend, with no powers of censorship nor authority to punish offenders, in the words of Governor Talmadge. That was left to others. It was to consist of three members, citizens of the highest moral character, who would meet monthly to investigate things they thought were bad for readers. Literature was defined in the statute as any book, pamphlet, paper, drawing, lithograph, engraving, photograph, or picture, but specifically did not include pictures used in projection of motion pictures or television. The Bible, weekly and daily newspapers, all federal and state matters, and all matter, reading matter used in the recognized religions and in scientific or educational institutions of the United States were exempt, as were radio, television, and film. Reverend Wesbury, who dodged Governor Talmadge until reminded by the chief executive of his duty to the people of Georgia, finally took the job, convened the commission, and got off to a poor start. As might be imagined, the commission found itself embroiled in a controversy over its purpose and identity from the beginning. First, there was Reverend Wesbury's fear that the commission would be made to look, by its very existence, like, quote, a monkey to the nation. Then, in response to a question about the potential offensiveness of certain works of art, quote, with more zeal for his task than common sense, Wesbury answered, I don't discriminate between nude women, whether they are art or not. It's all lustful to me. Westbury's biographer characterized the statement as the worst thing he could have said. The comment was reported everywhere. The media, from radio's Walter Winchell to Collier's Magazine to the International News Service, quote, made great sport of his remarks and inferred that if all nudity was lustful to him, then most of his thoughts must be evil. Westbury struck again, oblivious still, in the summer of 1953. When asked by a reporter to name some of the books which had drawn fire, the chairman replied that if he named any of the books, a lot of people would go out and buy them. His 1954 report to the legislature and the people of Georgia, titled Every Citizen Has a Right to Know, painted a lurid portrait of the state drowning in literary sewage. Lisby and the Georgia Encyclopedia report, the commission had some early successes, though. Most of the commission's early work was through a program of mutual cooperation with publishers, distributors, and retailers, although the commission became increasingly ineffective in its dealing with magazines, as it could prohibit distribution of a particular issue it found to be obscene, but not any future issue. In late 1956, four out-of-state publishing companies sued the commission in federal court on grounds that the statute establishing the commission was unconstitutional. A special three-judge panel ruled that the statute, as correctly construed, did not raise a constitutional question, because the court concluded that the commission did not have any powers of censorship. The commission could only recommend to distributors that a publication not be sold, or to prosecuting attorneys that a distributor be prosecuted. So the suit was subsequently dismissed, and the commission took to wagging its finger at publishers once again. Through 1967, the commission was required to take legal action in only six instances. The beginning of the end of the commission's efforts came on August 19, 1966, when the commission sought and received a declaratory judgment in Muskogee County Superior Court that Alan Marshall's now long forgotten novel, Sin Whisperer, was obscene. The Georgia Supreme Court also sided with the commission, concluding that the book was filthy and disgusting. The unanimous opinion continued, "Further description is not necessary, and we do not wish to sully the pages of the reported decisions of this court with it." The U.S. Supreme Court, however, reversed the judgment without comment in a memorandum decision and no explanation of why the book was not obscene, without any comment about the standards applied by Georgia courts determining it to be obscene, and without any ruling on the constitutionality of the commission itself. Other books chosen for review by the commission, given a new lease on life of sorts, were Erskine Caldwell's God's Little Acre, which they reached back to 1933, for J.D. Salinger's Catcher in the Rye, Norman Mailer's The Naked and the Dead, George H. Smith's Strip Artist, and John Dexter's Lust Avenger from 1965. Other commissions the commission tried to suppress included Swan's Campus Lust, Reese Hayes's Turbulent Daughters, and Betty Short's Rambling Maids. In 1964, Westbury went after James Baldwin's 1962 bestseller, Another Country, complaining it was obscene and also inflammatory, quote, because it was written by a Negro. The book, which featured interracial and bisexual extramarital relationships, had already been declared obscene in New Orleans, as with the commission's campaign against God's Little Acre, a full two decades after it was published. The commission's campaign against Baldwin, who was then a leading figure in the growing civil rights movement, looked to many like just wandering around trying to pick fights. By the end of its first decade, the Georgia Commission's work had produced precious little progress despite burning through $100,000 in taxpayer funds. The supply of offensive material outstripped its ability to review and evaluate it, and because it could not ban serial publications into the future, they had to go after naughty magazines month after month, one issue at a time. Some distributors complained that even though they thought they were cooperating by not selling certain titles, they never knew when the Attorney General, given the commission's latest blacklist, might determine they weren't and prosecute them. Others freelance their own notions of prior restraint, trying to pander to the commissioners. A Washington Post report found early on officials struggled to define exactly what constitutes obscenity in literature, eventually developing an 8-part test. Publishers and distributors tried to appease the board, with some even voluntarily withdrawing books. Hugh Hefner even wrote them, thanking them for differentiating Playboy from other, quote, gross and tasteless girly magazines. By 1960, the commission had failed to get a court ban to prohibit the sale of Erskine Caldwell's God's Little Acre, but it did manage to get distributors to voluntarily suppress 119 other titles. The trouble was that everything had to be tested next to those 8 criteria. And here they are. Try and find your way through a book with these. 1. What is the general and dominant theme? 2. What degree of sincerity of purpose is evident? 3. What is the literary or scientific worth? 4. What channels of distribution are employed? 5. What are contemporary attitudes of reasonable men toward such matters? 6. What types of readers may reasonably be expected to peruse the publication? 7. Is there evidence of a pornographic intent? And 8. What impression will be created in the mind of the reader upon reading the work as a whole? The courts began to turn in a new decade as the 1950s gave way to the 60s. And in the early 70s, a new governor, one Jimmy Carter, became the commission's nemesis. In 1971, after years of steady support, the annual appropriation for the commission was reduced by almost 20%. Ironically, then Governor Jimmy Carter's decision to cut the commission's budget coincided with his public pronouncements decrying pornography. He proclaimed May 9th through 15th, 1971 as Fight Pornography Week and declared his intention, quote, to do everything I possibly can to rid Georgia of pornographic literature and movies, and urging all Georgians to join in this fight. Jimmy Carter was a liberal, Westbury remembered in 1991. He didn't see the evils of pornography as we saw it. For his part, Carter spent his 4 years in the governor's seat trying to unload the moribund commission without yielding any ground on the need to stamping out smut. Lisby says in September 1972, he implemented a plan that would solidify his stance as tough on pornography, yet circumvent the need to shut down the commission. Carter chose to argue that while certainly not their fault, the commission had become no more than a mere complaint department and was completely ineffective in stopping the spread of obscenity, the result of recent federal court decisions that had, quote, placed enforcement responsibilities on the local level and left the State Literature Commission without enforcement power. He then named a new 6-member advisory committee on pornography with instructions to make a crash study of the pornographic situation in Georgia and to report back to him with recommendations for fresh legal action. The committee recommended the creation of a new literature commission with a special, quote, circuit-riding prosecutor on its staff. Nothing, however, finally came of this proposal, and no horse was purchased. Carter's last and most subtle tactic was to ensure the demise of the commission by taking no action at all. Both he and the next Georgia governor, George Busby, declined to appoint replacements for Commissioner William Perkle, who died in October 1972, and Hubert Dyer, who died in October 1973 at the age of 47. Thereafter, the three-member agency was precluded from conducting official business as it was never able to have a quorum. It was thus impotent and, as a consequence, legally inactive. Though Westbury never said so publicly, he held Carter responsible. Quote, "Some of the best people I know couldn't see what was wrong. It broke my heart. For when you're fighting obscenity, you're fighting the devil." From 1973 on, the commission's activities can only be described as its few last gasps for life. Westbury was then the only living commission member, and despite his efforts, his appointment, which officially ended on April 1, 1973, was never renewed. The last expenses deposit for the commission was made in June of that year, and the last minutes from a meeting were recorded in October, during which Westbury elected himself an interim executive director and telephoned the governor's office to request that Carter appoint two new members. The commission's last financial statement on file is for the quarter ending December 31, 1973. Finally, in January of 74, the Office of Budget and Planning rejected the commission's quarterly allotment request because it had not been signed by its legally chosen executive director, Hubert Dyer, who had died the previous year. Thus, the Georgia Literature Commission was completely paralyzed. This fact is reinforced by the words written in bold on the outside of Governor George Busby's file on it. Quote, "Not going to appoint," close quote. Westbury also retired as minister of the Morningside Baptist Church the following year to become director of the Lord's Day Alliance, an interdenominational group whose aim was to promote the Lord's Day as a day of worship, rest, family culture, and Christian service. Although the 1953 statute creating the commission was never officially rescinded by the General Assembly for what Georgia legislator would want to be seen voting for pornography, the new Georgia Constitution of 1976 authorized 8 constitutional boards and commissions and no more. The Literature Commission was not among them. Reverend Westbury died Christmas Day, 1992, at the age of 86. Among those surviving him and his commission was Jimmy Carter, former governor of Georgia and 39th president of the United States. And that's the end of our look at efforts in the last half of the 20th century to find a role for government in determining what we all should read. I'm Lynn Thompson, and that's the story behind the story. I'll see you next week.